knows our name. He knows the very number of hairs that we have on our head. He knows our fears. He knows our hurts. He knows our future. We serve an omniscient God who is sovereign in every way. Praise the Lord and welcome. We're so glad that you tuned in this afternoon. Before I begin preaching, I'd like to pause and offer a heartfelt thank you to all those that have contributed to our building campaign. By the grace of God and with your support, we have attained our financial goal. Currently, we are in the midst of refurbishing our building. In a few weeks, we anticipate having our first church service in our new sanctuary. We will walk in praising the Lord. Our GoFundMe account will still be active for the next few days. If God touches your heart and you would like to bless us as He has blessed you, we welcome you and we thank you for that. Our prayers that God may continue to enrich your life, and we pray for favor, blessing over your family, over your finances, and over your health. This afternoon, I'd like to speak on this topic, the party crasher. I would like to delve into a familiar biblical story, maybe give a unique application. And my purpose is to address the many saints that battle a certain aspect in overcoming condemnation and guilt. What is condemnation? Condemnation is a self-sentencing. You judge yourself very harshly for past mistakes. The devil will use two things to try to get you from present victory. That is reminding you of past mistakes, and if that is not successful, then he will get you to worry about your future, to bring anxiety. All this so that we do not enjoy the present that the Lord has given us. The party crasher. Luke chapter 7, and let's begin reading at verse number 36. My focus today is how do we overcome the belittling of critics when we come back to serving the Lord? Those that serve the Lord and are active in the church, maybe one day a mistake is made, you walk away from God for a season, you desire to come back, and it's hard enough to get past the guilt, but you know that you're going to come back and have to confront people that have known about what you've done, and that's very difficult. And I'd like to address that this afternoon. Luke chapter 7, verse 36, when one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him, he went to the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. A woman in that town who lived a sinful life learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house, so she came there with an alabaster jar of perfume. As she stood behind him at his feet, weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears. Then she wiped them with her hair, kissed them, and poured perfume on them. Verse 39, when the Pharisees who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, if this man were a prophet, he would know who is touching him and what kind of woman she is, that she is a sinner, the party crasher. What would inspire this lady to perform such an act? It was certainly due to the gratefulness that she had in her heart. There was no hesitation for her to open up an expensive jar of perfume and begin to pour that on the feet of Jesus Christ. We have to understand her past. She was a woman of the street, immoral in every way. The whole city knew how she earned her money. There was no decent person that would talk to her, especially not the high-minded, judgmental Pharisee. She was a lady of the street, but in that condition, she encountered Jesus one day. And Jesus came with the new message, thy sins be forgiven. Now go and sin no more. She was set free. She was liberated. But this lady still battled one thing. She had a terrible reputation. In a day that a name was meant to determine the very status in society. It was challenging enough now that she had been delivered to continue to resist temptations. But now she was not a slave to sin or a slave to guilt. But she still had to deal with the broken status of her name. No man would marry her. Every lady avoided her. They didn't even have the courage to have a conversation. She was prejudged before even meeting someone formally. She considered herself a plague. People would see her and walk on the other side of the street. She was an outcast at the zenith level. She was a disappointment to her family. Just being in her company would downgrade a person's reputation. She was known for destroying families and bringing down man. This lady was no longer in bondage to her past sins or to the shame, but she was in bondage to a broken reputation among the people. The entire situation left her without self-worth, in a web of disgrace. Many times it's not the past acts of sins that continue to torment us, but it's the lingering effects, the shame that affects us. I want to speak to those that feel enslaved to bad choices that you have made in your life. This lady had the ability to stop her lifestyle. She wasn't worried about her income, but she had to work on the damage with her critics. If you're facing remorse and condemnation comes through a progression. When we commit a sin, the first thing we deal with is a mental torment. That is triggers that remind us of the mistake that we made. Maybe we lay in bed at night and that occurrence goes through in our heads that we offended someone, we hurt someone, and it is a memory that is in our mind that leads to emotional suffering. Because of that, we feel bad. We feel unworthy. We feel that we have to atone. That could lead to depression, sadness, or just feeling down on ourselves. We cannot overcome the regret. We continually say, well, it was my fault. I ruined my life. I cannot go move on. I cannot forgive myself. It's an emotional cycle that I just cannot break. And after that, the next step in the progress is shame. Shame naturally brings a desire to want to hide. When Adam sinned by eating of that fruit, his first instinct was to find fig leaves, sew them together, and cover himself, trying to hide from the presence of God that would visit him every day in the garden. When someone borrows something and you do not return it on time, you keep that in your possession, and the person you borrowed it from, you may encounter at a store, at a supermarket. Sometimes it's hard to look at them in the eye because you know, and the guilt that you have, and you know that you have something that belongs to them. And maybe even you see someone and you want to walk the other way because of what you've done. You want to, shame forces you to want to walk away from the situation. And after that, after we go through the mental torment and the emotional suffering and the shame, that leads us to a level that we call condemnation. And condemnation, it is a stronghold. It's a trap. You get to the point where you say, I deserve punishment. I sentence myself. I am a lawbreaker. I am an offender. I just give up on myself. I accept my faith. I hold myself to the highest level of punishment. I condemn myself. I'll never be what I plan to be. I'll never achieve my goals. My dreams are not obsolete. Every circumstance in my life is probably due to past shortcomings. I live in paranoia, thinking that God is going to judge me because of what I've done. I live thinking that I'm going to be caught or confronted for something in my past. A person coming back to God has to overcome every one of these feelings. And by the grace of God, you will. You have to overcome the mental torment and the emotional suffering, the shame and the condemnation. But if that's not hard enough, one last final obstacle is before us in coming back to the Lord. And maybe it is the most difficult. And that is, how do I overcome the tarnish on my reputation? Nothing arouses arrogance and challenges our humility like a tainted reputation. 2 years ago, I found myself sitting in a restaurant across from someone who had committed a sin, a person who had been active at their church and ministry, but had been discovered or had confessed to a sin. And as I sat across, this person expressed to me how they felt the love of God. They felt the forgiveness of the Lord. They had repented before the Lord sincerely. But in wanting to continue to serve God and going back to church, they had to deal with the people. And they felt the stares. They heard the whispering. People that had greeted them before now seemed to walk the other way. It seemed like people would look at them and would give them a a ugly stare, not wanting to approach them. And this person looked at me and said, what do I do? Should I just be what they think I am? Maybe I don't care anymore. And this is when pride moves in. And this person then expressed a desire to want to move. And I looked and said, you cannot run away from this. You have to confront this, but God will give you the grace. Guilt is different from conviction. Condemnation is different from conviction. Condemnation is dealing and stems from past sins that have occurred, while conviction is dealing with current behaviors. Conviction is a sign that we still have a moral compass. That is the still small voice of God that reminds us what we are doing is wrong. It's a pricking in our heart. The closer we draw to God, the more conviction that we will feel. Isaiah said in Isaiah chapter 6, when I saw the Lord high and seated upon the throne, the first thing I said is, woe is me. I'm undone. I dwell in the midst of unclean people and unclean lips, and I am unclean. When we draw closer to the Lord, there will be conviction about certain things in our life that we must get rid of. We worry about people that stop feeling conviction, when they can lie with a straight face, when they can mislead and find excuses and it doesn't affect them or harm them. That is concerning and dangerous. But when a person feels conviction, it means that God is still working on them. Yeah, maybe there'll be times that we let our anger slip, or we let the pride pop up, or we just make an error in judgment, but God has allowed that conviction to come up to lead us to repentance. 2 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 10 says that godly sorrow brings repentance that leadeth to salvation. When there's conviction, God is still working on us. For someone who is condemned, they think that, and they're reminded of the constant bad choices that they have made in life. And today, if you feel condemned, if you feel ashamed, I want to let you know that if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away and all things have become new. You can have a new day. You can have a new lease on life. God can give you a new name. God can turn your life around. Maybe you've been labeled something in your past because of your past reputation, your past mistakes, but you can take on a new identity in Jesus Christ. Jesus has given you the same message. Thy sins be forgiven. Now go and sin no more. The blood can free you from every feeling of guilt and shame. You can walk away today feeling liberated in the spirit and in your soul because of the blood of Jesus that comes in and covers you. There's no sin that's too great. There's no sin that you can commit that is beyond the favor and the mercy of God. There's no behavior that you can do that's beyond the grace of a loving Savior. The blood can cover you. He remembers our frame. He knows that we are dust. We serve a God that has not dealt with us according to our sins, nor has He treated us according to our transgressions, but He treats us according to His loving kindness and according to His mercy. And His mercy is from everlasting to everlasting. His mercies are new every morning. My friend, God does not run out of mercy. If you sin, why don't you sin? Why don't you get up and continue to follow after His path? God is still working on you. But you see, the biggest obstacle that we face many times in coming back to the Lord after we have sinned is this thing called pride. It's even in feeling the conviction or the guilt, instead of reacting to that, we allow that to continue just to fester. And before you know it, it has grown to the point of condemnation. Saul dealt with this when he was chasing after David, wanting to take his life because he felt threatened. His position was threatened. And he told David, he says in 1 Samuel 24:17, you are more righteous than I. You have treated me well, but I have treated you badly. And then in verse 20 of that chapter, he says, I know that you will be king. Saul made a concession that he knew that David was destined to sit on the throne of God. He knew that David was anointed by God to be the heir to that position. He was a conflicted man. He was living in guilt, but at times he was very vulnerable to the Spirit of God. At times he would admit his shortcomings, but then the pride would come in and tell him that he was justified. And one day when David was about to kill him, he stopped and he said, "I will not touch the anointed of God." And Saul responded to him and said, "I have sinned. Come back, David, my son, because you consider my life precious today. I will not try to harm you again. Surely I've acted like a fool and I have been terribly wrong." You see, Saul was conflicted. There were times that he felt the conviction and said, I should not be killing this man. This man has been good to me. I remember this man killing Goliath. I remember when he was a young boy and he would play that harp before my presence. It would cool my jealous spirit. It would calm it down. This man is destined to be king. But when he would think those things and when he's about to give in to that conviction, pride would step in and would tell King Saul, "Don't give up that throne. Don't, you should be the king. It's your hierarchy. You should have the right to continue to wear that crown and have the scepter in your hand." Saul was reminded of that. He liked the attention. He liked the chance of women saying Saul has killed his thousands. He was not humble and he was not broken. You see, the greatest obstacle that we face in coming back to God many times is our own pride. We know that God is waiting with open arms, but we just cannot get past that hurdle and giving ourselves to the Lord because we're worried about what someone may think. We want to, but we just can't. I'm worried about the repercussion. I'd rather hold on and not apologize than to go down that altar where people might see me. My reputation is on the line. What are the saints going to think? They know what I have done. They will judge me. The story goes that when Saul, at the end of his life, in 1 Samuel 31, the conclusion of the story, Israel went to war and Saul was hit by an arrow by one of the opposing archers. And he did not want to die at the hands of the enemy. So he told one of his own armor bearers, "Why don't you pierce your sword through my side and let me die that way?" His armor bearer absolutely refused to do that. And Saul laid down his sword, and there he laid himself down, died in his misery. He died in his pride. He died in his guilt. He died in his condemnation. I know it's uncomfortable many times to face our own faults, to face our own flaws, but it's easier to change the narrative and to say, "You know what? I'm a victim." The story's more palpable that way. It's better to feel like I was justified. It's better to make excuses than to say I made poor choices. But I'm here to tell you that if you want to come before God, you got to come with a sincere heart. You have to come with openness and say, "I admit before you, I confess all of my faults before you." God cannot forgive you until you come with that broken spirit and you come willing to stand before his presence. And then after God forgives you, we have to forgive ourselves. Sometimes that is hard. And I understand that there's validity. Maybe you did suffer, but we're accountable to our responses. We're accountable to how we reacted in every situation. We cannot have selective memory, or we cannot be worried about what someone did. That is their responsibility before the Lord. But I'm responsible for what I did. Yes, I did hurt him. Yes, I did walk out on my spouse. Yes, I did walk out on my children. Yes, I was a bad father. No, I have not been living right before the Lord. I've been selfish. I've had an ego. I've sought revenge. I was wrong. And pride will say, "You don't have to do that. You don't have to face the scrutiny. You don't have to face the criticism that you might take. Stay home. Serve God from your house. You don't have to belong to a church body. Oh, but I'm here here to tell you that God will help you and he'll give you the grace to get back into the presence and the company of the fellow saints. God wants you to be part of the household of God. Don't worry about what others might say. And I want to give you just four things to do and to help you get past feelings and having to, once again, maybe confront people. And if you have walked away from God, you have fallen away and you want to return, but you're worried about the person's opinion about you and what they're going to think and if they're going to judge you harshly. And the first thing I want to say, number one, and we're going to use the story of this lady with this alabaster box, is that Jesus desires your company. Jesus desires your company. It was not uncommon when a man traveled from a far town and entered to a home that the servant of that home would attend to him. Men would walk for miles on hard, sometimes stony surface without the qualities of shoes that we wear today. Some men would even forego the sandals and walk barefoot. And as man would enter into a home as a guest, especially being a guest of someone who was wealthy, such as a Pharisee, the first thing that would occur is that the servant of that home would show that man to an area where a basin of water was located, and that man was able to soak his tired feet. Many times a servant of that home would assist that man and would towel off the feet for him. This lady, she heard that Jesus was to be a guest at a Pharisee's house one day. And the scripture says that she learned. In other words, she found out. It's my opinion that this lady was not invited to this home, but that she crashed the party. And she said, I want to be where Jesus is going to be. And this lady found the courage to march into the house of the man that represented the most formidable accusers that she had encountered, the Pharisees. She was not invited to this man's house. If anyone would judge her, it would be the Pharisees. And she walked into this party, this group of people that was there, this group of Pharisees, knowing that she would receive criticism, but she was there to see Jesus Christ. How could she find that type of fortitude to enter this man's room? You see, at that point, the critic that was the harshest was irrelevant, because her focus was not on the critic, but her focus was on the Savior. Her focus was on Jesus Christ. Her focus was not on her own pride, but her focus was on the Liberator. And she walked into the house and she said, I have to see him that gave me a fresh start. I want to see him that made all things new in my life. His presence is sweeter than any type of criticism that I could receive. Being next to him is greater than any cruel remark that I could hear on this given day. I just want to be with Jesus. And at that time, the Pharisee was unnoticed. The remarks didn't matter to her because she wanted to see Jesus. I don't care about the dirty looks. I've come with the motivation, and that is to serve the one that has forgiven me. Jesus wants your company. Jesus desires you. Yes, maybe people might talk until the new thing comes about, and you know, you're worried, oh, they're going to know what I did and how I blew it in college and how I made this mistake, and they're going to know everything about me, or I've heard about you. My friend, keep your eyes on Jesus Christ. Keep your eyes on Jesus Christ. The second thing I want to let you know is that you're safe in the presence of Jesus. She was safe because Jesus was there. Her Savior was present to protect her from insults and harshness. He was there to defend her from the accuser. There's safety in Jesus. If you feel like you cannot get past the mistakes, the blood covers all of your sins and all of your guilt. And the blood also covers and gives protection. Years ago, churches, when someone would make an error in judgment, they would sin. To the shame of that person, pastors would bring the person in front of the church and would announce openly the sin that that person committed. They would misinterpret scriptures that say mark those that cause division in the church. Or, and that scripture simply means to be aware of these people. But leaders of old would bring people in front and would publicly humiliate them and would share details of sins. He messed up. He went to the dance club. We found him alone. We found him alone with a lady. He was found at the club. And they would announce it to the church and maybe even put guidelines and saying, you cannot sit in the front. You cannot sit in certain places. You cannot talk to people. You have to sit in the back. You're not allowed at church events. Just sit there and go home. There's no fellowship for you. And the church as a whole lost many souls because of these mistakes. And today, maybe you've encountered that years ago. I want to tell you that there's hope in Jesus. We have learned. We have made mistakes. But Jesus loves you. Years ago, I was teaching at a camp. I was the daytime teacher, and the evening speaker was evangelist Carlos Cenicetos. And he had pastored in New York. And as we were eating lunch, he told me the story. He said, you know, one day I was sitting on the platform and there was a girl that we had discovered in sin. And I pulled her aside, brought her into my office. And I said, you cannot be singing in the choir. You cannot participate in youth events. We have a strict guidelines that you need to follow. And as I sat in church on a Sunday evening on the platform and the youth choir was introduced, the choir went up to sing. There she was sitting, singing in the front row. I began to stand up in my anger, and my intent was to openly pull her away from the choir and sit her down where she was supposed to be seated down. But when I got up from my seat, I felt a horse. It felt like a hand that was pressed upon my chest, sit me back down. And I tried a second time to get up from that seat. And once again, I felt a force sit me back down. And then I heard the voice of God tell me, she's not singing to you, but she's singing to me. My friend, you sing your praises. You have a right to offer your praise. You have a right to lift up your voice. Don't worry about the attitude of the Pharisees. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God, but you love on him and you bring your alabaster box and you open it up and you come in the midst of the critics and you ignore the stares and don't worry about the whispers because you have a God to praise and there's safety in the presence of Jesus Christ. Our church is not here to condemn anyone's. We do not throw stones. Let he that is without sin cast the first stone. None of us have a right to cast stone, but we have a simple message that he who the Son has set free is free indeed. There is liberty in Jesus. No more chains. I'm free to dance. I'm free to sing my song. You have freedom in the Lord. At our church, once you make amends, you're in fellowship full with Jesus Christ. There's no such things as status of fellowship. You've been restored to the body. There's no partial fellowship. It doesn't come with rank or with levels. The scripture says there's neither Jew nor Greek, bond nor free, neither male or female, but we are all one in Christ Jesus. Now to qualify that, there are certain stipulations and qualifications for someone that serves in church leadership, according to 1 Timothy chapter 3. But when you come back to the Lord, you come back in fellowship with him. The Pharisees wanted her to isolate herself. The Pharisees, if it was up to them, would say, go find a house and never come out. Go and we don't want to see you in public again. Go into hiding. Go and stay there. But Jesus says, come in. Jesus says, I welcome you. Jesus says, I'm here for you. I'm here to offer protection for you. She crashed their party that day. A few years ago, a good friend of mine who is a pastor and hosts a large conference with hundreds or perhaps even thousands of people invited Olga and I to go. And as we parked and entered into the sanctuary, we did not know, but an usher came for us and we were not aware of this. An usher came for us and he escorted us to the front row. And there we were seated with men, accomplished men, pastors of big churches, bishops, men with prominent positions. And as we sat there, we felt the stares and people asking, well, who are they? After one of the morning sessions, there was a dinner with a select few. And this pastor invited us to go. And as we sat eating at the table, once again, we felt the stares and maybe people asking or even wondering, what are they doing here? And I told the pastor, well, are you sure? Maybe we should leave and maybe we just don't belong here. And he simply responded, no, you're my guest. And he says, you're welcome to get whatever you want. The food is yours. I said, well, if that's the case, and I'm going to go for seconds. And I said, you know what? It had dawned on me at that point. I'm not there for them, and I'm not there for them. But I'm here because my friend, he invited me. And I made myself at home that day, and I began to eat. And we just began to have a good time. And we began to socialize and to talk with all the people. My friend, I want to let you know that Jesus wants you there. And Jesus will protect you. Our church is a hospital. It doesn't matter your past shame. It doesn't matter your past sins. And if there's current issues that you're still dealing with, if you have a broken heart that needs mending, we're here to help you. They that are whole need not a physician. They that are whole need not medicine or need a doctor, but we're here to provide hope to those that are pain and those that are broken. There's many that say, well, look, in the church, it's full of hypocrites. Well, I say this. Don't let the ties fool you, and don't let the suit and the dresses fool you. We're just like you. We're men of like passion that battle the same temptations, and we go through the same emotions, and we battle the same issues and the circumstance of life. But all we know is that we have found Jesus Christ. And when someone says, well, the church is full of hypocrites, you almost feel like saying, well, there's room for one more. Come join in. You're welcome to come. Welcome. We're all the same, and we're vulnerable and we're transparent before each other. This lady was not worried that the Pharisee did not invite her. And Jesus said, even though it's not my home, but you are my guest. You're the guest of Jesus Christ, and he desires your company. The third thing I want to let you know is that your service to God will always outlast your critics. Luke 7:44 says, he turned to the woman and said to Simon, the Pharisee that was hosting him, do you see this woman? I came to your house. You did not give me any water for my feet, but she wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. On this occasion, the lady was so grateful as she arrived to the house that she came in with the disposition and with the intent to say, I will be serve the role as servant of the house today. Servant, maid, take the day off. I will lead him to the basin, and I will wash his feet. And she came into the house and feeling so indebted to the Lord, she said, I'll do this duty with care. The Pharisee was so self-righteous that he refused the lady to even have rights to the basin of water. No, you cannot use our fresh water. You're dirty and you're stained and you shouldn't belong in this house. You're unwelcome here. Don't even ask for a towel. Don't even ask for the ointment and the lotion that we put on the feet. But you see, this lady said, that's okay. I don't need any of your possessions. I don't need any of those goods. I don't need the water, because the tears that I feel when I think about this man, when I think about all that he's done and where he's brought me from, there's tears that roll down my cheeks, and I will use those tears to wash his feet. I don't need your towel, because I'll pull down my hair and I'll begin to dry it as best as I can. You see, the people that criticize you, I want to let you know that you do not need their affirmation. You do not need their acceptance. Maybe someday you'll be accepted, or maybe you won't be. You may never walk in certain circles, or the eyes of people may never change their opinions about you. But my friend, I want to let you know that you're not there for a full audience. You're there for an audience of one, and that is Jesus Christ. We're not there to please him. We're not there to please others. We're there to please him. And this lady says, as the tears flowed, I'll wash Jesus's feet with my tears, and I'll use my hair as a towel. And if they do not give me the ointment and the lotion to put on the feet to help against the sores that he might have and to protect his skin, what I'll do is I brought my most precious commodity, the most valuable thing I have in my house that was passed down from generations. I'll
I'll bring my alabaster box that's worth thousands of dollars, but it doesn't matter because what this man has done. And she said, if you don't give me the ointment, that's okay. And she broke that alabaster box and she began to rub the ointment upon Jesus's feet. Now, this was not just a random act. This lady was in her mind, this was her way of being useful for the kingdom of God, for all that Jesus had done for her. A man's feet was to be well kept and well preserved. A man that constantly traveled from village to village had to have the proper shoe wear, or if anything, had to have his feet healthy. And in her mind, she said, as my service to the Lord, this man has to travel many more villages. There are many more crowds that he has to minister to. He has to walk many more miles on roads. And what I'll do is, as my service to the kingdom, I will take care of his feet and I will serve this role. And she broke that alabaster box in front of the religious crowd that day. Jesus was criticized. They said, this man, if he was really a prophet, he would know what type of a person that this is. And this lady, it didn't matter. She was willing just to wash his feet. You see, because someone who is grateful to God, there is no responsibility that is beneath them. They'll empty the trash of the church. They'll park cars if they have to. They don't need the VIP parking, or they don't need the pulpit time or the platform. Just give us a job to do. Just give me a way to contribute to the kingdom, because God has been so good to me. When I was a young minister, I remember the pastor pulled my wife and I in and says, I have a job for you. And it was not consisting of a position, or it wasn't consisting of notoriety or a position that would put us in front of people. He says, there's a new convert and I want you to give her a Bible study every Sunday morning, because I don't see how she can fit in any one of our classes. And with passion, Olga and I for 3 months would go into a room and we would prepare like we're preaching to thousands, and we would begin to teach her and expound the word of God more perfectly. It was my service to the Lord. And you see, someone who has a gratitude, an attitude of gratitude and a spirit of thanksgiving to the Lord, I don't care if I have to be the cook, whatever I have to do to enhance the kingdom, that's what I'll have to do. I heard the story of Sister Mickey Mangan, a pastor's wife in Alexandria, a pastor's wife who has sang before presidents, who has sang at inaugurations of presidents, who has recorded and made CDs that has gone out to thousands of people and has a church of thousands of people, highly influential. And she said, my greatest thing to do in serving the kingdom is to serve in bus ministry, because I love serving kids. It's my way of giving back to the kingdom. I do it for the people. And you see, this lady said, I may have done what they're accusing me of. I may even be what they think and what they say I am, but I have a God that I will serve. I will just continue to serve him. I'm not worried about their opinion. And Jesus turns to the Pharisee. He turns to Simon. He says, those who have been forgiven little, love little. He says, but those that have been forgiven much, they love much. You see, how do we overcome the accusations? Well, Revelation tells us that the devil is the accuser of the brethren. He accuses us day and night before the throne of God. He tries to trap us. He tries to bring guilt into our life, but we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testimony. What is the word of our testimony? That is our acts of service unto the Lord. The lady could not restore the marriages that she had broken. She cannot undo the damage to the lives that she had that hurt. She could not give that back the money that she had earned from her promiscuity. She could not even give back that which she had lost and undo the harm that and the changes that she had caused. But she could love him with everything that she could, and she could serve him with everything, even if that meant falling on her knees and using her hair as a towel. But she wanted to overcome by the blood of the and by the word of her testimony. And my friend, I want to let you know, you may not be able to reverse the mistakes of your life. And I know it's tough, and especially when there's damage that's irreparable. And you may have heard a family member that passed on. You never got the chance to apologize, or you walked out and you'll never have the same relationship with your children. You'll never take back the years that you lost to alcohol or to drugs, or you broke a vow that was sacred. There's no way to get that back. There's no way to get back the money that was wasted. I lost out on my calling. I lost out on my dream. I broke my pledges. And the accuser, the devil, will rise up and will say, you'll never be what you were supposed to be. But my friend, when the devil comes in, you begin to serve and you begin to love God and you begin to say, I'll go out, and if I've got to witness to a stranger, if I've got to sweep a parking lot, if I've got to give a dollar, that's what I'm going to do. And in time, you're going to defeat the enemy. You will outlast every one of your critics. The last thing I'm going to say, that in time, God will lift you up in due season. You continue being faithful. You continue overcoming, ignoring the whispers. You keep focusing your attention on Jesus Christ. Jesus openly rebukes the Pharisee. His name was Simon. And he said, I came into your home and you did not offer water for my feet. But this lady, as soon as she came in, she charged and wanted to make sure my feet were clean. You took my presence for granted. But this lady came and she dropped down her hair and she used her hair as a towel. And she took the best ointment that she had. You were unwilling to give her the ointment and the lotions and the creams that you had, but it didn't matter to her. He says she took her alabaster box, that valuable commodity. She could have sold that and gotten a lot of money, but she used it on my feet. And there was Jesus. He validated this lady openly. He stood her up in the midst of all of her critics, and he said, oh, Simon, you ignored me. You took me for granted, but this lady here, I'm going to validate her, and in the midst of all of you, I will defend her, and I will speak on her behalf. You see, years later, when the gospel writer got the pen and began to write the gospel of Luke, and he began to being empowered by the Holy Spirit and being inspired by God, he began to write down notes from this story, and he began to remember this lady, and being inspired by the Holy Ghost, he wrote the story. And the Pharisee who had forgotten Jesus was just a footnote to the story, but the theme of the story is this lady, because her act was not forgotten. Her act is still talked about today in our circles. Those that talk about you and those that criticize you, those that take the presence of God for granted, will soon be forgotten. But those that are faithful, those that serve, those that overcome their mistakes, in time, God is going to raise you up, and God will bring you forward, and God will promote you in due season. Just like the prodigal came, and when he was feeding the pigs, he said, I will go back to my father's house, even if it's just as a servant. I'll go back and I'll serve. I'll be a butler. I'll do the hard labor. I'll go out in the field and I'll be a farmer. And as he approached his father's house, the father met him out in the road and he hugged him and says, welcome. He said, I'll be a servant for you, dad. Just take you back into his home, into your home. And that father looked, what are you talking about? I'll give you back your position. You're my son, and you're back into full fellowship with the family, my friend. And even though the people talk about you and you're willing to come in as a servant, you're willing to come in and say, I'll just do the light duty, in time God will say, I'll give you your calling back. I'll give you your dreams back. I'll restore your broken dreams because of your faithfulness to me. I'm going to give you back everything that you lost. I'm going to restore to you the years that the cankerworm has stolen. I'll bring it back in abundance in your life. The gifts of God are without repentance. I'll restore the gift back to you. I'll open up doors for your life because you did not let the sin stop you, and you did not let the shame stop you, but you continue to rise up. A just man falleth 7 times and riseth back again. My friend, you passed the test, and because of that, God is going to exalt you in due season. He'll bring you back. He'll shut the mouth mouth of every accuser in your life. He'll lift you up in their midst. Your enemies will come in one way and they'll leave seven ways. And those that have talked about you, those that have criticized you, those that have whispered about you, they'll be left in awe when Jesus lifts you up, because you've been faithful and you've been committed to him. You served and you love. God will fight before you. God will fight on your behalf. Right there where you're at, if you have encountered guilt in your life and you're battling shame and you're having a hard time of restoring yourself back to the family of God and back to serving God, and every time you do it, you feel weighted down by shame and guilt and condemnation, I'm going to invite you right there where you're at to lift up your hands. If you think in your mind, I'll never be what God wanted me to be because a mistake I made 5 years ago or 10 years ago or 20 years ago, my friend, cut under the blood, and God is going to bring you. That's just part of your story. That's part of your journey. Just keep being faithful to God. Lift up your hands where you're at. I invite you to, if you're feeling guilt and shame, just call on the blood of Jesus. If you need courage to face your detractors, no, crash the party. Come in. Jesus wants you to come in. He wants your company. Lift up your hands and let's begin to worship the Lord.
Folks whisper, there's no place here for her kind. Still on she came, through the shame that flushed her face, until at last she knelt before his feet. And though she spoke no words, everything she said was heard. As she pour her love for the master from her box of alabaster. Now I've come to pour my praise on him like oil from Mary's alabaster box. So don't be angry if I wash his feet with my tears and I dry them with my hair. 'Cause you were there the night he found me. You did not feel what I felt when he wrapped his loving arms around. Wash his feet with my tears and I dry.